Welcome to second part of lecture number 8. As in the first part, we have discussed the general hydraulic structures which is used in the irrigation engineering. Okay. So now in this part, we will discuss the canal headworks. So canal headworks are the different types of the hydraulic structures. Yeah, canal headwork is a term used for any structure at the head or divergent point of a waterway or divergent point of a canal. Okay, or divergent point of a natural waterway or a natural stream or a natural river. For example, if this is the natural stream or a natural waterway or a natural river, and let at this point we are going to take out an irrigation canal. So any structure which is required to construct at this point, at the head of the canal, at the uptaking point, this is called the canal headwork. Okay, any structure or any work which is constructed across the river, which is constructed across the river and supply water to the uptaking canal, that is called the canal headworks. Okay. See, if the river discharge is not constant, and suppose if the river discharge is irregular, so obviously when a permanent canal system is taken up from the river, some work are to be provided at the uptaking point to take care of irregularities in the river from conditions. Okay, suppose if there is irregularity, if the flow is not constant, so then some permanent structure will be required so that some amount of water may be stored and the irregularities in the river flow condition may be avoided. So since these works are constructed at the point of the uptake, that is at the head of the canal system, so that's why they term as the canal head works. Okay. And the main objective of the canal head work is to divert the water from its natural flow direction, to divert the water from the river into the canal. It is sometimes termed as the divergent head works. Okay, generally we can call it canal head works, but it can be also called as the divergent head works, because the main purpose of these structures are to divert the water into the canal. So to achieve the main objective of water diversion from the river and to the canal successfully and efficiently, we will have to follow some steps. So the first step is we have to construct an obstruction. Okay, an obstruction or a barrier is constructed across the river. So when a barrier is constructed across a river, so what will be the function that barrier serve? So we can say that it will obstruct the natural flow. Okay, so if the natural flow is obstructed, so obviously its level will be raised and it will be diverted into the irrigation canal. See, it will raise the water level in the river locally at the canal uptaking point, at the canal head point, and that will helps in maintaining the gravity diversion. Because if you are not constructing this barrier, then you will have to cut too much area from this portion so that the gravity flow may the water may be diverted by gravity. So to reduce the excessive cutting of the canal in the head reach, we will have to construct here a barrier. So it will raise the water level, it will obstruct the natural flow, and the water will be diverted into the canal. Okay. Second one, it reduces the fluctuation in the level of the river. As we have discussed that if the river is irregular, if the river flow is not constant, and remember in canal we have required some regular and uniform discharge. So for that purposes we have to construct a barrier so that some amount of water may be stored and the discharge which is entered into the canal, that may be uniform. And see, as the water is obstructed, so the velocity is reduced and the water drops down at salt. Okay, if there is some sediment, so it will be drops down at here. okay, and that before passing that water into the canal system, so it creates a still pond at the upstream level of the canal, and the water which is entering into the canal will be free from the sediments up to some maximum level, not completely but up to some level. Okay, second one, also see, if we construct a barrier here, and suppose you are taking an irrigation canal at this point, so already as we have discussed that at this point we have to construct some regulator structure. Okay, so some regulatory structure will be constructed at the canal entrance or at the canal take up point or at the canal head point. See, it gives proper control over the supply into the canal for irrigation purposes. And see, it will prevent the flood water entering into canal. Also, it will allow only some predetermined discharge. Okay, that what is your requirement? So that amount of discharge will be only allowed to enter into the canal. And also, it prevent the excessive silt entry. Okay, so these are just the main function or the main purpose of the canal head works, that it raises the water level in the river, it regulates the supply of water into the canal, it controls the entry of silt into the canal, it provides some sort of storage for a shorter period, it reduces the fluctuation in the level of supply in the river. Okay, so that's why this structure will be it constructed when at a specific point you are taking out a canal for the irrigation purposes from a natural stream or a natural river or any natural waterways. Okay, so see, can head work, that is any structure, yeah, that is a term which is used for any structure at the head or divergent point of a waterway. Okay, so we have two types of the divergent headworks. One is the storage headworks and second one is the divergent headworks. So storage headworks is that headwork, that is a type of permanent barrier which completely stop the flow of water. Okay, for example, if that is the natural river and you completely stop the flow of water, for example, if you construct a dam, so if dam is constructed across the river to form storage reservoir, and then the water will be diverted into the canal, then this barrier, this headwork will be called the storage headwork. Okay, and see, suppose if the river flow is not completely stopped, but just a type of barrier is constructed which only raise the level of the water at the upstream, and the extra water will be allowed to over that barrier, then it is called weir, and it is a type of divergent headwork. It is just mean diverting the water, not completely stopping the flow. Okay, so that is the weir or barrage which is constructed across a perennial river. Remember, that is the difference, that when we have to construct a storage headwork and when we have to construct a divergent headworks. So remember, if the river is not perennial, okay, suppose if the discharge or flow in the river is not available throughout the year, then we have to construct a storage barrier. Okay, so the water which is available suppose in those months when the water is available, it will be stored, and in the off season when the water is not available, then it will be applied in the irrigation canal. Yeah, we can say that then also that amount will be stored for the off season. So you will have to completely stop the flow of water. Remember, when the river is not perennial, and when the river is perennial, it means that suppose in the river the flow is available throughout the year, then there is no need to completely store it, yeah, completely stop it. Okay, so then only the divergent headwork will be required. Okay, divergent headworks are of two types. One is the temporary divergent headworks, and the second one is the permanent divergent headworks. Okay, so see, temporary divergent headworks are constructed across the river to raise the water level in the river and will be damaged by floods. Okay, suppose if you have a natural water body, natural river, and suppose there is the possibility of the occurrence of the floods. Okay, so for example, if you construct a permanent structures, then there will be more chances of its damaged by the flooded water. So, in place of constructing a permanent structure, we are only constructing a temporary structure because its construction cost will be less. And for example, if it is damaged by the flood water, so then we will reconstruct it. Okay, so in place of permanent structure, you will have to construct a temporary structure. And remember, the temporary structure will be reconstructed after it is damaged by the floods. And for example, if the river flow is a type of, we can say that uniform flow, and for example, there is no too much chances of the occurrence of the flood, then such type of permanent barrier or permanent structure will be constructed. Okay, it consists of a permanent structure which is constructed across the river to raise the water level. Okay, so then there are two types of the permanent. One is the weir and second one is the barrage. Okay, so see what, again, as we have discussed in the first part, that what is weir? It is just a small barrier, okay, which is built across a stream or river to raise the water level. Remember, the main purpose or the main function of dam, weir and barrage are same. We have to just raise the water level at the upstream side, okay, and we have just to divert the water into the irrigation canal. So only there is just the construction difference between the structures. The main purpose or the main objective is same. Okay, so weir is just a small scale dam which allow the water to pool behind it, and while allowing the water to flow steadily over top of the weir. Okay, see, if there is a natural river and suppose you construct a weir, so at the upstream side, the water level will be raised and a type of pool will be formed, and the extra water will be allowed to overflow that structure. Okay, then based on the design parameters, we have two types of the weir. One is the gravity weir and second one is the non-gravity weir. The gravity weir is furtherly divided in vertical drop weir, sloping weir, parabolic weir. The sloping weir is either masonry or dry stone weir. So see, we will discuss one by one. Okay. So, as we have discussed, that hydraulic structure which supply water to the uptaking canal is called headwork. Okay, headwork may be either storage headwork or diversion headwork. So here you can see that if you are completely stopping the flow of water by a permanent obstruction, okay, so see, the water level is just stopped. Okay, so that is called the dam structure. Okay, and here you can take out a canal from it, and you can see that the bed level of the river is here and the canal is taken out at this point. So the water level is raised by this much height. Okay, and here you can see that suppose if this is the river or canal and you are taking out another canal from this one. So see, here a type of obstruction is constructed. Okay, so the water level at this upstream side will be raised and it will be safely diverted into the canal. Okay, and the extra water is discharged into the downstream portion, mean it is not completely stopped. So this is an example of barrage. Okay, here also you can construct a weir if the water is overflowing on it. Okay, and here at the head of the canal, see, some regulator or control structure are constructed which is regulating the entry of water into the irrigation canal. Okay, see, the main purpose of the headwork are just to raise the water level in the river so that more land be irrigated and the command area can be increased. Okay, if the water level is increased at the upstream level, then more water will be diverted by gravity. Okay, so more water will be available in the canal. It regulates the intake water into the canal also. Okay, it also control the salt entry. See, if a type of pool is forming here, so the velocity will be reduced and the salt which is present in the water, it will be deposited here. You can also see that the sediments will be deposited in the in this dammed water. So the salt entry into the canal will be controlled. Okay, also it reduces the fluctuations in the level of water supply. Okay, for example, if the river is supply is irregular, so see, in the canal we have required some uniform discharge. So to maintain that uniformity, you will have to store some amount of water so that the uniformity of the canal may be maintained. Okay, also a canal headwork can also store water for small period of time, as we have discussed that. For example, if for the shorter time period, if the flow is not available in the river, so you will have such amount of water which can fulfill the irrigation requirement. So it will also store a water for some shorter period. Okay, so then we have two types. One is a storage headwork, second one is the diversion headworks. So the storage headwork include the construction of dam across the river. Okay, it stored water during the period of excess supply. See, the storage headwork will be recommended on those river or on those natural stream or lakes where the flow is not perennial. Okay, so in those months, yeah, in those periods when the supply is excess than the requirement, so it will be stored by a permanent structure, it will be stored by a dam structure. Okay, and then it will be released when the demand overtakes the available supply. Okay, if the discharge in the natural river is reduced and your demand is more for the irrigation purposes, then you can divert, yeah, you can utilize that stored water. Okay, so storage headworks can be used where the flow in the river is not perennial, and the diversion headworks when the river is perennial. Okay, when the flow, yeah, when the water available in the canal is throughout the year, then there will be no need for its storage purposes. So then you will have just to divert the required supply of water into the canal from the river. Okay, so then only diversion headworks will be constructed. And again, the purpose of the storage headwork and the diversion headworks are same. We have just to raise the water level, we have to regulate the entry of water into the canal, we have to control the silt entry into the canal, and we have to reduce the fluctuation. We have to just provide a uniform supply of water into the canal. Okay, see, these are the different types of the diversion headworks. You can see that this is, for example, a natural river or a natural stream. Okay, so here a type of obstruction is constructed. Okay, so the water level at this upstream side has been raised. Okay, and due to this raising up level, the water will be safely diverted into the irrigation canal. Here you can see that the bed level of the natural stream is lower than the bed level of the canal. Okay, so to ensure the gravity diversion, you will have to construct such type of barrier. Okay, and if there is a number of gates, okay, yeah, if the extra water which is beyond the maximum level, it will be, for example, if it is overflowing on the structure, then it will be a type of weir. Okay, and here you can see that this structure, that is called the regulator structure or the flow control structure. Okay, remember, that is not necessary that only the diversion headworks will be only constructed on the natural river or natural stream. Suppose if you have the main canal, and for example, if you are taking the water for the sub main canal, so again some diversion structure will be required to be constructed in the main canal. Okay, so here you can see that is a type of barrage. So it is raising the water level at the upstream side and ensuring the gravity diversion into the sub main canal. Okay, and again, this one is the regulator or the control structure. Clear? So the main purpose are just to divert the water from one direction into another direction by gravity. Clear? Diversion headworks may be either temporary or permanent. Okay, see, temporary are those which are constructed after every year if there is the occurrence of the flood. So if you construct a permanent structure, and for example, if the flood occurred, so it will damage the structure, so it will be a type of loss. So in that cases, we are recommending the temporary structure that, for example, if it is damaged by the flood, then it will be reconstructed. While weir and barrage are permanent structures. Okay, so they are only constructed on perennial rivers where the flow is uniform and not too much irregular. Okay, temporary structures, they are the structure which are temporary or and usually are constructed every year after the flood. Okay. Now see, as we have discussed the headworks, storage headwork, diversion headworks, then the temporary headworks. Now we have to discuss the permanent headworks. So in the permanent headwork, the first one is the weir. Okay, so let's see the different types of the weir, or the main components of the weir, the main body of the weir. Okay, so at this level, we are only introducing the different components and the different types of the weir up to the introductory level. We are not going into details or into the designing of the weirs. Okay, so see, the permanent weirs, it is a solid obstruction which is put it across the river to raise the water level and divert the water into the canal. The weir can be used for storage purposes. See, for example, if this is a natural stream or a natural river, so here we have just to construct an obstruction across the river. At the height of this abstraction will be depend on the level up to which you are rising your irrigation water, so that it may be safely diverted and entered into the canal by gravitational forces. So this abstraction is called the weir. Okay, and when the water level is raised up to the required limit, then the extra water will be overflowing on this structure. Okay, see, storage weir, if weir is also stored water for small periods of time, for example, if the flow is if the discharge in the river is less, and suppose you stored that amount of water per shorter period, then that weir will be also called a storage weir. So the difference between the storage weir and dam is this one, that the weir is storing the water a little bit per shorter duration. Okay, and small amount of water is stored, and a dam is storing comparatively water for longer duration and have more volume. Okay, so that is the difference between the storage weir and dam. Now see here, you can see that this the black structure which is constructed, that is the main structure of the weir. Yeah, that is called the total body of the weir. Okay, so if we draw a side view, so see, if that is the natural stream or a natural river, so such type of barrier is constructed on the river. Okay, the height of this barrier will be depend on your requirement, that up to how much height you are raising the water level. Okay, so up to this much the water level will be raised, and the extra water will be overflowing. Here you can see that the extra water is overflowing on this structure. Okay, so now see, depending upon the design criteria, the weir may be either gravity weir or non-gravity weir. Okay, now see, if the water level if the water is raised up to this level, so it will exert some pressure on the ground. Yeah, due to this standing water, some water will be entered into the soil, and which is called the seepage, mean the entry of water from the water bodies into the soil, that is called the seepage. So here you can see that this is the low pressure area, and here the pressure will be more due to the standing water. So now this water will be moved below the weir body. Okay, here it will seep down, and it will come here and will try to raise again to the downstream portion of the original river above the bed level. Okay, so when it is rising here, yeah, this seeped water will exert some uplift pressure on the body of the weir. See, when the water is entered into the ground, so basically it will exert some uplift pressure. Now see, when the weight of the weir is such that it, for example, if the weight of the weir is equal to that uplift pressure, yeah, if that uplift pressure is resisted by the weight of the weir, then it will be called the gravity weir. Remember, that is the one of the main favor mode of the weirs. Okay, so if that uplift pressure is resisted by the weight of the weir, then it is called the gravity. Okay, the uplift pressure due to seepage of water below the floor is resisted entirely by the weight of the floor. You have to construct the weir from such weight of material so that it may resist completely the uplift pressure. Then such weir will be just called the gravity weir. Okay, see, the type of weir in which the uplift pressure is due to seepage of water, the floor is resisted entirely by the weight, then it is called the gravity weir. Okay, when the weight of the weir, see, it's these are the floors, the downstream floors, the upstream floor, and the body wall. Okay, its body and floor weights, if it balance the uplift pressure, yeah, if it exceed the uplift pressure caused by the head of the water seeping below the weir, it will be called the gravity weir. Okay, now there are different types then based on the material, that from which type of material, yeah, what will be the basic shape of the weir. So then there are three types of the gravity weir. One is the velocity drop weir, second one is the sloping glacis weir, and third one is the parabolic weir. Okay, so let's see. Okay, before going into the discussion or introduction of the types of the gravity weir, let's clear the different terminologies. Okay, so keep in mind this structure. that is the, see this black structure, that is the complete structure of a weir which is constructed across the river. Okay, if that is a river, so here we will construct the main body of the weir. The downstream floor will be made impervious, and the upstream floor will be constructed as impervious. Okay, so these are the floor of the weir, and this is the main body of the weir. Okay, see here you can see that this is the downstream floor, this is the upstream floor, okay, and this is the main body. So now in the main body, here you can see that the body wall, okay, and you can see that the body wall at the bottom, yeah, this thickness is more than the top thickness, because if water is stored up to this limit, so then the pressure which it is exerting is equal to gamma H. Okay, so the pressure at this point exerted by the water will be more than the pressure exerted at this point. So this is called the main body wall. Okay, the body wall of the weir. So it is a wall which is constructed to raise the water level. Actually, this wall is responsible for raising the water level on the upstream side. Okay, to raise the water level on the upstream side. So, and this wall will be strong enough to resist the water pressure, because maximumly the pressure will be acting on this wall. So it will be strong enough to resist that pressure, and also it will be strong enough to resist the uplift pressure. Okay, as we have discussed that the pressure which is exerted by the seepage water. Okay, now here you can see that this is called the upstream apron. Okay, mean the upstream floor. So it protects the weir from erosive forces during floods. Yeah, when the water is coming towards the structure, so it will cause the erosion of this upstream side. Okay, so to protect the main body wall, we will have to make this portion impervious. So that is called the upstream apron. Okay, it protect the weir from erosive forces. And also, see, the length of the apron depend upon the discharge in the river and the length of the weir. Okay, because if the length is more, then you will have to provide more stability, and it will strong enough to withstand the downward water pressure, because if here the water is stored, so it will exert some downward pressure. So the upstream apron will be strong enough so that it may resist the downward water pressure, and also it will strong enough to resist, yeah, to prevent the leakages. Okay, mean to avoid too much seepage of the water. Okay, so it will be properly impervious. Then we have the downstream apron. See, these are the general parts of the weir which will be in each and every types, both in gravity and non-gravity, vertical, glacis and parabolic. Okay, the downstream apron. Again, see, when the extra water is flowing over the crest, okay, so it will be acting in the downward portion. So this downward portion will be some type of concrete floor will be provided, because it will have some high kinetic energy. So if this downstream apron is not provided, then a type of depressions will be made, and the soil will be eroded from this downstream area. Okay, so to reduce the kinetic energy of water, okay, it will be depend upon the height of fall. Mean the length of the apron and the thickness of the downstream apron will be depend on the height of the fall. If the height of the fall is more, then the more kinetic energy will be there. Yeah, its impact will be more. Okay, so it will depend on the height of fall. It will depend on the nature of soil. It will be depend on the discharge in the river. Okay, and the apron is extended. And the apron is extended up to the point where there is no scope of erosion. Okay, suppose if water is falling, so there will be high chances of the scouring or erosion from the downstream area. So its length will be more. Okay, and the downstream apron should have sufficient thickness to resist the uplift pressure, because here the water will be entered into the ground, and it will move under the structure and will try to raise up at the downstream area. So its thickness will be more as compared to the upstream apron, because here some standing water pressure will be exerting downward, so there is less chances of the uplift pressure. And here the water actually rising at the downstream area, so its thickness and strength will be such that to resist the uplift pressure. Okay, then here you can see that the upstream curtain wall, and this one is the downstream curtain wall. Here you can see that this thing, this is a type of foundation, okay, a type of foundation at the downstream area, and this one a type of foundation at the upstream area. Okay, so the upstream curtain wall that reduce the uplift pressure, mean it provides more stability, it provides more resistance. Okay, so and also to increase the length of seepage, to reduce the effect of the entry of water, okay, a type of upstream curtain wall will be constructed. And the downstream upturn wall, again, that protect the downstream flow from uplift pressure, again it providing some stability, some more resistance, and that will be strong enough to resist the kinetic energy. Okay, and see, one is this portion on which the water is flowing, that is called the crest. Okay, yeah, here you can see that this top level, when the water level is reached up to this required limit, then the extra water will be flowing over that body wall. So this top surface of the body wall is called the crest, okay, top of the weir, and again it will be strong enough to resist the excessive pressure. Suppose when flood is occurring, so then there will be excessive pressure along the direction of flow, so this crest will be, again it will be strong enough to resist that pressure. Okay, and sometime this shutter is provided. Okay, here a type of gate is constructed on the crest. Okay, for example, if you have to raise, for example, required more water level, so then the shutter will be operated, or the shutter will be opened. Okay, it will strong enough to resist the water pressure. Okay, so this is a type of movable gate, and it will be operated when some more height of the water is required. Okay, so these are just the different terminologies, or these are just the different parts which will be constructed during any structure, for example dam, weir, or barrage. Okay, so that is called the crest level, that is the highest level, the surface over which the water flow, that is known as crest. Okay, so the crest, the body wall, the shutter, downstream apron, upstream apron, upstream curtain wall, downstream curtain wall, and the rest of these structures, these are the supportive structure. It will provide the more stability to the structure. Okay, now see, what is vertical drop weir? So a vertical drop weir consists of a vertical drop wall with or without crest shutter. Okay, either there will be a crest shutter or not. Okay, sometime if you need some more level to raise at the upstream side, then the shutter will be installed. Okay, and see, suppose that is the natural river, so just a vertical structure is just constructed. Okay, so the water level will be raised up to this limit, and the extra water will be overflow above the crest and will be vertically fall down. So that is called the vertical drop structure. Okay, piles are provided at the upstream and downstream end of the impervious floor. See, these are the piles are the downstream, we can say that the downstream and the upstream curtain wall. Okay, similarly, to control the scouring action, okay, these upstream apron will be provided, and the downstream aprons will be provided. Okay, it provides with shutter. Okay, if shutter is provided, so it will raise the water level against the crest. Okay, and see, remember, these different types of the gravity weir are depend on the types of the foundation. Okay, there, for example, if you are constructing a weir in a river, so what is the type of the foundation, either it is rocky soil or sandy soil or loose soil or compacted soil, so what type of weir will be constructed so that the erosion at the upstream side and the downstream side may be completely avoided. Okay, so just the shape of the weir will be changed, and the basic principle will be same. What is that principle for the gravity weir? That the weight of the weir will resist the upward pressure, only just the shape will be different. Okay, second one, we have the sloping glacis weir. So see, suppose if that is the river and you just construct a vertical wall and then the crest, and for example the water level is raised up to this point and the extra water will be dropped vertically, then it is called the vertical weir. And see, if that is the river, suppose you constructed a sloping upstream side, then the crest, and then the sloping downstream side. Okay, so these sloping sides, yeah, these sloping banks are called the glacis. Okay, see, the water are not completely stopped by vertical construction, as in vertical, we can say that in vertical view. Okay, see, the upstream side, a little bit, we can say that upstream sloping glacis is provided and downstream glacis is provided. So the water will be stored up to this limit and the extra water will be sliding on this glacis, on this sloping glacis. So what will be the advantage? See, if the water is vertically falling, so there will be more chances for the erosion. And if the water is overflowing in such way, then there will be less chances for the erosion. So if the soil is loose or sandy soil, then the sloping weir will be recommended. Okay. And also you can say that if different type of material are used, for example, if this sloping weir is constructed from masonry or concrete, then it is called concrete or masonry sloping weir. Okay, and if it see, such type of weir are suitable for soft sandy foundation, because if in sandy foundation you construct the vertical weir, then the overflow of the water, it will cause more erosion. Okay, and see that, and they will be generally used where the difference in weir crest and downstream river bed is limited to 3 meters. Okay, mean if this the crest level and the downstream level, if that is from 3 to 5 meters, then the concrete masonry sloping weir will be recommended. And at such level, then the hydraulic jump will be created. So we will have to avoid the production of the hydraulic jump. Okay, hydraulic jump is just a phenomena when the liquid at high velocity discharge to a zone of lower velocity, because see, that is a glacis bank, yeah, that is a steep slope. So obviously the water velocity will be more, and here the slope is reduced too much, so the velocity will be reduced. So when the water is flowing from high velocity region into lower velocity region, then the hydraulic jump is created. Okay, so it is a type of, we can say that it is a type of hydraulic phenomena. Okay, so at this level, at such level, the hydraulic jump will be created and the energy will be dissipated, and the erosion at the downstream portion will be avoided. So such type of sloping glacis is just the sloping bank. Okay, so the water will be raised by sloping bank and also it will be discharged by sloping bank. Now if this weir is constructed by masonry or concrete, then it is called the concrete and masonry sloping glacis weir. And if it is constructed by the just by the rock pillar stone, okay, suppose if that is a river and upstream side glacis, then the crest level and then the downstream glacis. See, if the material is used as just rocks or dry stones, then it is called the dry stone sloping glacis weir. Okay, they consist of, again, upstream wall and downstream wall just consist of the rock pile. Okay, simplest type of weir, the weir body and a few intervening core walls are made. Okay, such type of core walls are constructed for more stability and more resistance of the uplift pressure. Okay, the upstream and downstream rock pills are laid in the form of glacis. Here you can see that, and these are just the average recommended slope through which you can form the glacis at the upstream side and the downstream side. Okay, and the shutter may or may not be provided. It is suitable in mountainous region only where large quantities of the stone is available. Okay, in mountainous region, for example, if the masonry work is not suitable, or in for example, if it is expensive and if the stone is available, then such type of weir will be constructed. The third type is the parabolic weir. So again, the upstream side is a little bit vertical, and here you can see that the overflow, yeah, the extra water beyond the level on the crest is flowing in the parabolic direction. Okay, and here a type of cistern is constructed. Okay, cistern is just a type of we can say that a stilling basin. Okay, that is a type of tank for storing water. Okay, see if the level is raised and it is falling here, so it will have high energy, it will have high kinetic energy, it will have high flowing energy. So to dissipate that energy, to break out that velocity, we will have to provide a type of storing tank. So first water will be occurring here and will be stored for some shorter time, and it will dissipate that energy, and then it will be allowed into the downstream portion. Okay, again the rest of the structure is same, that is the downstream apron, this is the upstream apron, this is the main body, this is the crest, and the shutter may be provided or not, these are the curtain wall or these are the piles. Okay, in parabolic wear, a cistern is provided, okay, to dissipate the energy of the flowing water. The upstream and downstream protection work are similar to that of the vertical drop, mean the rest of the structure are same for all of the vertical and sloping wear. Okay, so these the body wall for such wear is designed at a low dam. Okay, mean that is all types of the wears are just acting as a low dam structures. Okay, so these are the different types of the gravity wear. So as we have discussed that if the uplift pressure is resisted by the weight of the body of the wear, then it will be called the gravity wear. It has three types, that vertical, sloping glacis and parabolic wear. Now see the non-gravity wear. As we have discussed that suppose if that is a river and you just construct here an obstruction or a barrier, so the water level will be raised at the upstream side and the extra water will be allowed to overflow on this structure. So see, due to this ponding water, due to this standing water, and also due to the pressure of the standing water, some amount of water will be entered into the ground, which we call seepage. So then it will exert some uplift pressure on this structure. So if this uplift pressure is resisted by the weight of the floor, then it is called the gravity wear, as we have discussed. Now see, if sufficient material is not available or if sufficient space is not available to construct the gravity wear, then the body of the wall and the upstream apron and the downstream apron are constructed from reinforced concrete. Okay, so now see, if it is constructed from reinforced concrete, then the uplift pressure will be counter-attacked by the bending action of the reinforced concrete. Okay, so if the uplift pressure is resisted, if the uplift pressure is resisted by the bending action of the reinforced concrete, then it is called the non-gravity wear. Okay, so we have to keep the thickness of the aprons such that, and also we have to reinforce some steel bars in these floors, and the thickness will be more so that the uplift pressure may be resisted by the bending action of these floors. So then its damage will be avoided. Okay, the thickness of the floor is kept relatively large. Okay, the thickness will be kept large and the uplift pressure will be resisted by, this term is also okay, the thickness will be less because the uplift pressure, we are not resisting the uplift pressure by the weight. Okay, so if we are not resisting the uplift pressure by weight, then the thickness may be kept relatively less as compared to the gravity wear. Okay, this term is okay, this is less. See, the thickness of the floor is kept relatively less and the uplift pressure will be resisted by the bending action. As compared to the gravity wear, the thickness of the floor in the non-gravity wear is less. Okay, why we are keeping more thickness in the gravity wear? So that the weight may be increased. And here we are not resisting the uplift pressure by weight, we are only resisting it by the bending action. So the less thickness of the reinforced concrete floor will be constructed and it will resist the uplift pressure. So then it is called the non-gravity wear. Okay, then it is called the non-gravity wear. And see, the one more terminology is, for example, this is the wear. So the water will be stored up to this limit and the extra water will be overflowing on the crest. So the surface of this flowing water, that is called the nap. Okay, the surface of that flowing water is called the nap. The flow of water that moves over top the crest, okay, is known as nap. And see, and that is the level, this H. See, up to this level the water will be stored, then the extra water will be overflowing on the crest. Now see, during the flood this height will be increased. Okay, so when the weir is obstruct, when the weir obstructs the flow of water in the river, the water heads up on the upstream side of the weir. This rise is maximum during the floods, and the amount by which the level rises above the normal level is known as, then it is called the efflux. Okay, see, these are just the different terminologies. See, that is the river, this is the weir body, the water will be stored up to this limit, okay, and the extra water will be overflowing on the crest. So the surface of this overflowing water, this surface of the overflowing water, that is called what? That is called nap. Okay, and see, the extra water which is overflowing on the weir, it will have some height. Okay, it will have some height. Now during the flood season, this height will be maximum. Okay, this height beyond the storing level, this height will be maximum. So the amount by which this level raise from, suppose, H1 and to H2, mean the difference between these two heights, yeah, the amount by which the level rises above the normal level, that is called what? Efflux. Okay. Now, also we have to look out the flower moods that due to which condition, yeah, due to which phenomena, the weirs will be failed, and what will be their remedies. Okay, so see, this is the main shape or the main body of the weir, the upstream side and the downstream side and the main body. Okay, so now see, piping, rupture of floor due to uplift, scour on the upstream and downstream, rupture of floor due to the suction caused by standing water, and these are the different phenomena, yeah, through which the water may be failed. Okay, so see, what is piping? So at permeable soil, water seeps at the base of the weir. See, if the soil is permeable, so the water will be entered into the soil, which is called the seepage. So when the flow lines at the downstream end emerge of the impervious floor, when these water which is entering into the soil, for example, if it come out at the downstream area, if it emerge out at the downstream area against the impervious floor, so due to the hydraulic gradient, the water will exceed this flow. Okay, and at this stage also the soil particle will be damaged, and that particle will be removed from this path and will be eroded. So further concentration of flow will result more soil removal, and this process will be continued, and a type of conduit will be formed, a type of tunnel will be formed, a type of we can say that channel will be formed, that is called the piping. Okay, and it will make the floor, we can say that the floor will be affected. Okay, the structure will be affected. So now, what is the control of this piping? So to provide sufficient length of the impervious floor so that the path of percolation is increased. Okay, a proper imperviousness is provided at the upstream side and the downstream side, then the length of the moving water will be increased. Okay, and the percolation length will be increased, so the effect of the gradient will be decreased, and not too much effective piping will be occurred. And also providing the pile, okay, yeah, the curtain wall at the upstream side and the downstream side, they are more effective in the avoiding of the piping. Okay, next one is the rupture of floor due to uplift pressure. So as we have discussed, that when the water is entered into the soil, so it will come back at the downstream portion, and it will exert some uplift pressure. So if the weight of the floor is not sufficient to resist that uplift pressure, then the floor may burst out. Okay, then cracks will be produced, and the effective length of the impervious floor will be reduced. So in this way, the final failure is due to reduction of the effective length. So we will have to keep this length more, and we will have to keep this length, thickness will be more, so that the weight of the floor may be sufficient to resist the uplift pressure. So these are the control measures to provide the sufficient impervious length and appropriate thickness, and to providing pile at the upstream side and the downstream side, okay, mean the foundation wall, so to provide more stability and more support to the upstream structure. Second one, third one is the rupture of fluid due to the suction caused by the standing water. Okay, for example, if here the water is standing, so it will exert more pressure at the upstream area, and at the downstream area only the atmospheric pressure will be exerted. So this is the low pressure area, this is the high pressure area, so a type of suction will be occurred here. So due to this suction, okay, due to this suction at the downstream area, we can say that the outflow pressure will be increased, and the mean it will added into the uplift pressure. Mean one is the uplift pressure and one is the suction. Okay, so if the floor thickness is not sufficient, then some cracks will be produced or bursting will be occurred. So again, that is the control that providing some thickness to the downstream portion, it will counterbalance the extra pressure which is occurring due to the suction. Okay, and constructing the floor thickness in one concrete mass instead of masonry layers. I mean, if you are constructing one layer, then another layer, then another layer. So instead of constructing different layers, you have to construct just one thick proper concrete layer. Okay, see at the downstream area, this concrete floor, it will resist the uplift pressure and it will resist the suction pressure. The next one, most important palaver which is possible in the divergent structures, that is the scouring on the upstream side and the downstream side. See, when the water is coming towards the structure, so it may cause the scouring at the upstream side, and when the water is flowing over the structure, so due to its falling or due to its kinetic energy, there is high chances of the erosion of this downstream area. Okay, so see, when the natural waterway up a river is contracted, so the water may score the bed both at upstream and downstream level, because when we are constructing the weir or barrage or any structure, so we are trying to construct these structures in the narrow portion of the river, so that the length of the structure may be reduced. So when such work is constructed in the narrow stream and the narrow river, then it means that the river is contracted. Okay, so when it is contracted, so the velocity will be increased, so there will be more possibility or more chances of the erosion at the upstream side and the downstream side. So again, that is the control that we have to provide some proper piles and the concrete bed at the upstream side and the downstream side, so that these two pervious portion may become impervious. Okay, and so that it may resist the scouring at both sides, and also some suitable length will be provided. Okay, up to some proper length they will be constructed, so that the main wall of the weir, so that the damage of the main wall is reduced. Okay, the possibility of the damage is reduced. Okay, so this was all about the different hydraulic structures. And then we have discussed generally introduced the headworks, storage headworks, divergent headworks, okay, the temporary divergent headworks and permanent divergent headworks. And then we have discussed the different types of the weir, okay, the gravity weir and the non-gravity weir. Okay, so this was all about lecture number 8. Thank you.